I welcome all of you. Thank you for joining us. Like Snikriya Foundation, I'll slightly introduce this is Special Needs Integration Center. We are coming up in Nagpur. Basically, our motto is to provide conducive environment for children with special needs so as to facilitate their development, education, help them develop their potential to the fullest, enhance their independence and enable them to become a well-adapted individual in society. Like we have very scarcity of the services in Nagpur, so we are thinking that why not to have all the centers and all the facilities under one roof, like recreational community support center, rehabilitation center, vocational training center and daycare center, and finally, of course, residential hub. So for that, all the projects are in the pipeline. Our motto of Snikriya Foundation is to educate the parent and develop their perspective toward the right kind of intervention and treatments. Because these days I have seen the people are getting dragged into wrong kind of a perspective and the various treatments. So to provide authentic information to the people, we are trying our best to get you all the authentic seminar, webinars, and information for you. So today we have Mrs. Mukta Jatkar with us, an excellent special educator and remedial therapist. Apart from that, apart from her degrees, I personally go for my kids to her since last 6 years. So I have a wonderful experience with her, and my kids are very much got improved with her help. So I'll hand over to Mrs. Mukta ma'am. Please, ma'am, you can continue.
Thank you, Harshali, for inviting me to host this webinar today, and all the best for your new venture.
Thank you.
Let's start with our presentation. I will answer the queries towards the end of the presentation, but during the presentation, if anyone has any difficulties, you may post the questions. What is special education? What role does it play in our children's life? That is what we are going to just learn about it. I'm sure all the parents are part of the special education team, and they are continuing the therapy with their kids. So when we talk about special education, it is how do you discriminate than general education? So when we talk about special education, it is identified by who is giving the therapy and who is receiving the therapy. Special education can be sometimes differentiated by its curriculum, what is taught. We all know the curriculum which we plan for our children is different than the kids who study in regular education or general education. It is also identified by where it takes place. Whether it takes place in the resource room in the regular school or special school or residential school, that is how it becomes different than regular education. It also differs in how special educator teach the children, the kind of methods we use, and the methodology or techniques or teaching aids that is little different, or sometimes the teaching aids which are available in the market are adapted for our kids. Who are children with special needs? So these kids are those whose physical attributes or learning ability is different from the norm, either above or below, that they need special program, and those are special kids. So these are the disabilities I think we all are familiar with, children with mental retardation, children with ASD, borderline intelligence, giftedness, speech disorders, children with ADD, ADHD, physical impairment like cerebral palsy or orthopedic impairment, and multiple handicap where child has more than one disability. Then how do we usually say that this child has or may have special needs? So usually the developmental milestones are delayed, such as delay in walking or speaking. They are unable to cope with their grade level academically. Their sitting tolerance is poor. They have speech difficulties. The children with ADD or ADHD daydream most of the time in the classroom or even when they are at home. In some cases, some children appear as they are shy or withdrawn. They get distracted very easily and they distract others. They do not mix with age mates. Or sometimes some of our kids do get bullied by classmates also and kind of become clown of the class. How do I know if I have a learning disability and maybe you have a teaching disability? Sometimes like we often face these things where children do have difficulty, but sometimes teachers also find it difficult to accommodate them in the regular education or regular class. Just the quick facts, there is no cure as such for any disability. Every individual learns to live with his or her disability over the period of the time with the help of intervention, of course. Ratio in disability is usually 1:4. Like behind every one girl, there are four boys who get diagnosed with some kind of disability. Now, learning disabilities like dyslexia, dysgraphia are different than being slow learner or having mental retardation. They are not the same. Mental retardation is different than being slow learner. Mental retardation is also different than mental illness. Mental illness such as schizophrenia or any kind of mental problem the child or individual has. Then gifted children who have above average intelligence also come under special education program, and they do help, they do need help in nurturing or especially for their emotional well-being. So special education plays important role in the case of gifted children as well. Some gifted children do have dual diagnosis like learning disability or ADHD. Autism and ADHD are different diagnoses because sometimes some of the reports I do come across, they are used synonymously, but they are not the same. Children with ASD may have associated disorders such as mental retardation or borderline intelligence. And some children with physical impairment may or may not have associated disorders. Now, what are the challenges which are faced by individuals with disabilities? Need of understanding. They also need to be understood by the society and by the family members, neighborhood. They also have need to be belonged, need to be accepted by family or peer group and society by and large. They need to be taught to deal and live with their own limitations and strengths. And they do need professional intervention. Now, what is the importance of early detection and intervention? So once the child gets diagnosed, maybe the detection has taken place early, but the intervention sometimes is started little late. So what could happen if we do that way? Or sometimes the detection takes place very late and so the intervention is also started late. It is important to identify any child or any student at the earliest to start the intervention. You need to understand the root cause of the problem, as sometimes the poor language skills can lead to academic difficulties. This I'm talking in the reference with children with learning disability or ADHD. You cannot label the student to start intervention, especially in the case of SLD, that is specific learning disability, and ADHD before they turn 7 years. Early intervention will minimize the academic difficulties in future and it will also reduce the stress on the family. And it also prevents secondary handicapping conditions. Now, why do we need special education? So all children have right for education. No child should be left behind. No discrimination in the society. And if they are integrated, it also prepares the regular children to be sensitive towards the children and accept them as part of our society when they grow up. Now, when we talk about special education, it is not the job of only one profession. It is a multidisciplinary team. As you can see, developmental pediatrician, clinical psychologist, psychiatrist, special educator, speech and language therapist, physiotherapist, occupational therapist, regular education teacher, parent, and sometimes the child with individual himself or herself is also part of our team. Now, of course, the need of therapy will vary from child to child. The child who has probably cerebral palsy may need the help of special educator, speech therapist, physiotherapist, and occupational therapist. Whereas the child with learning disability may need help of special educator and occupational therapist. So it depends upon the diagnosis of the child, and it also depends upon the need of that child, what kind of therapy the child needs. So as you can see, the role of each professional, it is very important to understand whom you are taking your child for diagnosis. And accordingly, that individual or that professional is going to help you out. See the person and not the disability. Now, what is the role of special education team? So, like I said, the child with any special need need to undergo formal or informal assessment. Then the remedial program is planned, or if the child is going to occupational therapist, sensory integration program or the program for fine motor skills is planned for the child. Then the next step can be implementation of that program on one-on-one basis or in a group, depending upon the need of the child and the kind of targets you have set for the children. Collaboration with classroom teachers and parents is very important. Like I said, it's a teamwork. So it's very important to involve the classroom teachers or regular school or sometimes even special school if the child is attending that particular school. So it's the collaborative effort. That's what you should all remember as a parent. Then when we talk about therapy, ongoing assessment and documentation also is very important, where you can evaluate the child's progress and if any modifications need to be made or if any goals need to be reviewed, that is what we can do. So there are few centers where you get everything under one roof. Otherwise, most of the professionals are working in isolation, but still you can still have a collaboration if you have a common child coming to each of you. Now, what are the educational setup or placements when we talk about special education? So some children do attend regular school. So they do sit in regular class and receive special education. Now it is mandatory to have special educator in all the schools. So the special educator in the school helps the child to learn in the regular class. Resource room is a setup or a separate room, which is a part of a regular school, and the child receives the therapy in that setup on one-on-one basis or in a group, depending again upon the need of the child. Then there is self-contained classroom where special education from special teacher is provided in a separate class. And it could be part of the regular school itself. And the children attend the self classes in self-contained classroom according to their IEP, like 50% time or 60% time. That is what is kind of defined in the child's educational plan. Then we also have special school or separate school for catering the needs of children with special needs for particular disability. For example, the child who is blind probably will attend blind school after certain years in regular education, or children with mental retardation will attend the school for mental retardation. Then we also have vocational center or sheltered workshop that is usually part of special school setup, which individuals with disabilities are trained to work for a specific job. Then homeschool, where this is relatively new concept and where parents work with their own children and they receive special, the children receive special education in the setup which is as good as home. Of course, the guidance and training is given by the special educator or and also speech therapist or occupational therapist depending upon the need of that particular homeschool. Then residential school or residential facility where children are placed in residential school, especially if those educational services are not available in some parts of the country. We all have to remember that it's a service and not a place. Before we plan any program, we need to understand the normal development of the individual. So when we talk about normal development, it is not only physical development, but also the cognitive development. What is the level of the child's language? How is child functioning socially and emotionally? How is child mixing with others? So as we all know, like, okay, after the child is born, he starts crawling, or he starts sitting, or he starts standing and walking at particular age. He starts speaking particular words by the age of 6 months. And that is how we have to observe the developmental milestones in the children. And this kind of we use as a baseline information for any particular child who is referred to us. So what we do, we take the data or we take the information from the children. That is, we call informal information, where we usually ask the developmental history of the child. Then we also look for the birth history, and that helps us to understand the level or present level of the child. And on that basis, the curriculum is planned. Because that is how we all are educated. But when we study in a general education school or regular education school, we have one standard curriculum for the group of children. But when it comes to special education, we have a separate curriculum, again, kind of divided into all the domains of development. Like physical development, we have gross motor skills or fine motor skills or perceptual skills. So we plan the skills or activities or goals for the children on the basis of that. For example, if the child is having difficulty in gross motor skills, the activities or the targets are set with the help of physiotherapist and occupational therapist along with the special education special educator, whether the child will be able to throw the ball or catch the ball, whether the child will walk, how to teach the child to walk with alternate feet while climbing up the stairs. So there are lot of things which are involved in physical development. Again, it varies from child to child and from diagnosis to diagnosis. Then we also set the goals for the cognitive development or intellectual development and concept development. And we do plan the activities or the areas in that particular domain. Now, language development. When we talk about language, it is not only expressive language we should focus on. We should also see whether the child is understanding what we are talking. So that is very important. If there is no receptive language, there won't be any expressive language. Then we also have to plan for the social skills of the child, identifying the emotions, then self-help skills or ADS skills, that is very important part of our curriculum. And we as special educators give more importance to ADS skills because than over the academic skills. Now, what is IEP, Individualized Educational Plan? So it is a written document of specific targeted goal, which is mentioned in your document. Like I said earlier, the present level of performance is mentioned, the strengths and the need of the each individual. The long-term goals are divided into short-term objects. Now, long-term goals are usually annual goal, which is divided into short-term objectives. And it is defined in the plan that by the end of 3 months, this is what the child with learning disability will be able to achieve. For example, he will start reading one sentence. Or if there is a child with mental retardation, probably the objective can be the child will be able to fix jigsaw puzzles of 6 pieces at least with 70% accuracy. 70% accuracy means out of 10 times, at least the child will be able to do it 7 times. So this is kind of a very technical plan, but it helps us to evaluate the child's performance at the end of the month or at the end of the week. It also mentions the kind of accommodations or modifications or adaptations required to the child, and the review is done at the end of the 3 months or weeks or year or 6 months, depending upon what we have planned for that particular child. Teaching aids play a very important role when it comes to remedial education. Teaching aids can be visual, auditory, tactile, depending upon the learning style of the child. It is very important to identify the learning style of the child and select the appropriate teaching aid or prepare the appropriate teaching aid if required. They are usually prepared by educators. Most of the times we do get now ready-made educational toys or aids in the market. Those can be adapted according to the need of our children. It is very important to have patience. So even if the child is making even a slightest progress, it's still a progress when we look at it. Now, what are the challenges which are faced by parents? When the diagnosis is done, it definitely comes as a shock. The parents go through the denial stage where they are not accepting that it is, how can this happen to me? Then they start looking for therapist or therapy center. Sometimes they do kind of shopping, which we call go from one place to another. Okay, yaha fayda nahi ho raha hai, chalo yaha karke dekhte hai. Yaha nahi ho raha hai, waha ja ke karte hai. And with the advanced technology now, you can consult anyone across the world for input or for consultation. Gradually, they come to the acceptance that, okay, this is what my child has and I need to do certain things which are required for my child's growth and development. The other challenges are also seeking support system. Now, who are our support system? So family members, parent support group, and professionals. So parents also need help of family members. If they are living in a joint family, it is very important that the grandparents understand the need of the child and cooperate the family or parents. Parent support groups are very effective nowadays. Online groups are there and parents share information across the country. Professionals are also there to help the parents and to support the parents. some parents go through some relationship issues, like among couple after the child's diagnosis, or couple and family, or if the sibling is there, then so-called normal sibling and couple, then family and society, or parents individually. So they have a lot of things to kind of deal with, and we as a professionals are always there as a support system to these parents to help them go through these things. Another important thing which parents need to do is taking a lot of decisions. Now, where do they need to make decisions? When can they start therapy? At what age? Do I have to wait for special education services, or in short, like remedial for particular age, or the child should obtain certain level and then only I can go to the special educator? Then selecting therapist or therapy center, which therapy center will be of good help to my child, whether this particular therapist will be effective for my child's growth and development. Then also they need to decide at the priorities and which therapies are really necessary for my child on the priority basis. Then frequency of each therapy. That is the, I think, very challenging question for all the parents, that how many times should we go to the therapist? If the child needs all the therapies, then how will I prioritize that? How many days should I go to the occupational therapist? How many days should I go to the special educator or speech therapist? That is also a very important decision they have to make. Along with all these things, financial planning. Because it does cost some investment, I will say, in the therapy you all make as a parent. And that planning is something the parents need to decide, because sometimes there is only single member of the family is earning, and then financial strain can be there, or both the individuals are actually working, but maybe either of them, usually mothers have to take a break in their career so that she can give proper time to the child and take the child to different therapies. Then another decision all parents need to make is the medium of instruction. In which language should I teach my child? So that is the very important decision, because we are multilingual country. And English is, even though our one of the most spoken language in the country, but we usually don't speak English at home. So usually we as special educators suggest parents, depending again upon the level of the child and the diagnosis of the child, that it is always better to teach the child in his or her mother tongue. Then another decision which parents need to make is which school my child should go. Should I send my child to regular school, or should I try for special school, or should I, whether homeschool will be more beneficial? And it is very difficult for parents. Then as they grow up, in some cases of disabilities, the kind of vocational center you want to choose for the child, then residential facility, if the parents are getting old and there is no one to look after the adult who is with special needs. So these are the few areas where parents have to make decisions. And as a special educator, we definitely help parents to make these decisions, which will be in the benefit of the child. Now, what happens mostly when it comes to handle the children with special needs? I've seen this, I'm talking out of my experience, we cannot generalize it, but private tutor is appointed by parents to improve his or her performance, because some parents still get confused between special educator and general educator or regular tutor who are actually trained to teach regular children but not children with special needs. And then they feel that, oh, why can't my child still perform the way I want to perform or the way he or she should perform. Then in some families, the child is punished physically or verbally by using abusive words. Then without assessing the root cause of the problem, remedies are started at home or at school. Student, school or board is changed by the parents. Especially this happens in the case of children with learning disabilities. Okay, CBSE में नहीं कर रहा है, चलो मैं state board में डालती हूँ. चलो state board में नहीं डालता है, फिर मैं special school में डालती हूँ. And also it happens with the children with borderline intelligence also. I have seen it happening. Then alternate therapies are provided or it is given more importance, I can say, than core therapies. Then in some cases, we have seen that special education services are not continued for a longer period and are discontinued even though they are suggested. Now the reasons could be anything for discontinuing. Now which points the parents should remember? Teaching life skills is more important than academic skills. Make sure that your child receives therapy from respective qualified and trained professional. I will highlight this point because I have seen some quacks practicing in the city where they are not actually trained and they are not even qualified in that particular area and they are working as special educator or they are working as speech therapist. One particular incident I would like to share, that one of my students was going to speech therapy. And I just asked him, who is that speech therapist and what is she really doing with your child? And they were taking him every day. Okay. And then the parents said, nahin, wo na every day ABCD likhwa rahi hai aur 1, 2, 3, 4 karwa rahi hai. Main boli, ye to speech therapist ka kaam nahi hai. To aap kiske paas ja rahe hai? So it so happened that they were going to someone who was working just as an assistant or someone in at some speech therapist. And she called herself speech therapist and opened her own center and was providing services. So as a parent, it is very, very important whom you are taking to the child. And it is your right, I can say, to ask the credentials of that professional also if required. So when you take the child to the special educator, make sure the individual or that professional is qualified either in degree program, so it is called BEd special education, or diploma in special education. Now another important thing what you have to remember, that you have different training programs for different disabilities. So for example, I'm trained to teach or I'm qualified by qualification, I am authorized to work with the children with mental retardation, cerebral palsy and learning disability. And I need to take separate training and have to go through various workshop and training programs to teach the children with autism spectrum disorder. Because when I graduated, there was no specialization in autism spectrum. So from my experience, I can tell you, even though I was master's in learning disability, still I was not able to teach children with autism without training. So please remember, when you choose the professional, whether that professional, even though whatever degree that professional has, whether that child person has upgraded their knowledge and whether they are providing proper therapy. Then in some places I have also seen the stepping into someone's therapy. So in the past I have seen that occupational therapist or physiotherapist is working on remedial goals or language goals, or special educator is providing OT. Because sometimes parents also feel that acha ye qualified hai to isko sab aata hoga. And I will give you my opinion, like when parents say ki madam aap ye nahi karwa sakte hai kya, to mujhe bolna padta hai nahi, main uske expert nahi hu, aapko occupational therapy ke liye occupational therapist ke paas hi jana padega. मैं स्पीच थेरेपिस्ट नहीं हूँ, आपको स्पीच थेरेपिस्ट के पास ही जाना पड़ेगा. सो प्लीज रिमेम्बर व्हेन यू डिसाइड वेयर यू वांट टू टेक योर चाइल्ड टू. अनदर इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट आई वुड लाइक टू हाईलाइट इज द चाइल्ड विल डेफिनेटली बेनिफिट फ्रॉम वन ऑन वन थेरेपी. Because in some center, I have also seen, or this is the feedback which I get from parents, that one teacher is teaching many children, or two, three therapists are working in the same room. So definitely it is going to distract the child. Of course, if the goal is group learning, then yes, the child will learn in a group. So again, you have to go back to your IEP and see whether the objective is that the child will learn in the group of two or in the group of three. Then it justifies that one educator is working with two, three children at one time. Another important thing we always tell parents to have patience to get results. It's not going to be a miracle in a day or in a week that we can provide or produce results, because each child has a different level and each child will achieve the targets according to his or her level. We cannot push the child into something just because we are providing the therapy. Another suggestion I usually give to the parents, that minimize the therapist or doctor shopping or center shopping. They will be going to two or three places at one time. Some children are receiving occupational therapy more than one therapist. It's going to confuse parents and it's also going to confuse the child, because even though there are two occupational therapists or two special educators, the approaches are different. And it is going to contradict the goals which we set for the child in his or her IEP. Of course, you can change the therapist or change the center if you don't get the result in particular time which is being promised to you, or which is being told by the therapist ki 6 mahine mein ye itna karne lagega to kyun nahi ho raha hai, to chalo aap second opinion ke liye ja rahe ho. But otherwise I don't really suggest to go through different therapists just because other parents are going. Another important thing which all the parents have to do is to avail the disability certificate. Some parents, I understand, emotionally are still not in a state of mind to accept it ki my child has disability or my child has special needs. But it is better to obtain the disability certificate as soon as possible. You will get various benefits, depending upon the, again, I will specify the kind of disability and whatever the government has mentioned in their provisions. But definitely at least some percent can be reimbursed of whatever you have invested in the child's therapy, or you get income tax exemption. And we can have a separate webinar probably on that particular topic. Another important thing is financial planning for your for the therapies of the children and also for the adulthood, because you have to remember your child is child only till 12 or 13 years. It is a very short period if you look at the life at large, and you need to plan for the child's adulthood. So prioritize the therapies, prioritize the finance accordingly, according to the need of the child. It is very important. Then parents should get trained and educated to work with their own children. In my practice, I usually make the parents sit along with the child. I work with one child at a time, and I ask parents to sit with their pen and book, and whatever I'm doing, they will write it down or they will observe. Sometimes I make parents to work with the child in front of me. So I will just make sure that parents are using the techniques appropriately. Like I always say, it is a teamwork. I alone cannot make much difference in your child's life. So it is very important that parents need to get trained and educated to work with their children. I have wonderful friends who are actually parents of special children, and they have turned out qualified special educator and again reaching out to many children with disabilities and their families. So you may empower other parents by getting trained and educated. But one important thing which you have to remember, just that may not authorize, just getting training will not authorize to work with the children independently unless you get a RCI number, that is the Rehabilitation Council of India give one professional number to all the professional. So some parents may decide that, okay, I want to be in this profession, and then they can go for proper degree program or diploma program according to the need of the child or according to the disability of the child. Now we have a lot of online parent support group, but now that offline parent support group concept is really missing out. And I personally feel it is very important because you need like-minded parents where you can take your child to play with, like a play date or buddy. It is very important for our children to get the house where he is or she is accepted the way he or she is. So offline support group is very, very important in today's technology or digital world. Of course, not until the COVID-19 is being controlled, not before that, but it is very important for you all parents to be in contact with at least one or two parents who can be a support system to you. Don't follow other parents blindly when it comes to choose therapy and therapist or school or medium of instruction. Many a times parents come to me ki usko to apne English medium bola hai, to mere bachche ko aap Marathi medium kyun bol rahe ho? So again, it depends upon the child that what child will benefit from. Don't compare your child with another child with same or different diagnosis. Achha, uska bachcha progress kar raha hai, mera kyun nahi kar raha hai? Achha, wo maa ne therapist badli, isliye ho raha hai kya? Chalo, main bhi therapist badal deti hu. Always work on the strengths of your child to overcome the weaknesses. Don't lose hope and never give up. Another important thing which I would like to mention, when it comes to special education, what I have experienced that parents reach out to us very late for some reason. Sometimes they feel that it is, when it comes to special educator, it is only to do with the academic part. I guess it's the lack of knowledge or ignorance where parents feel ki agar haan, abhi to bachcha writing ke liye tayar nahi hai. Aur sab cheeze writing ke liye hi होती है. जैसे मेरे पास काफी पेरेंट्स जो पहली बार आते हैं वो इसके लिए आते हैं और उनको जो थेरेपिस्ट भी भेजते हैं वो ये करके भेजते हैं, हाँ अभी आप राइटिंग क्लास के लिए मुक्ता मैडम के पास जाओ. तो मुझे बताना पड़ता है कि राइटिंग इज नॉट द ओनली ऑब्जेक्टिव विच वी हैव फॉर अवर स्पेशल चिल्ड्रन. देर आर वेरियस थिंग्स विच आई हैव मेंशन अर्लियर इन माई स्लाइड ऑल्सो. वेन इट कम्स टू रेमिडियल एजुकेशन, academic is only one part of it. And like I mentioned earlier, early intervention is very important. So if the goal is sitting tolerance is not only going to come only by going to occupational therapist. You need to have a remedial intervention to get the sitting tolerance. So parents feel ओके चलो ओटी तो मैं कर रही हूँ, अभी उससे सिटिंग टॉलरेंस आ जाएगा. ओटी से सिटिंग टॉलरेंस जो आएगा वो उसके सेंसरी इश्यूज अगर बैरियर होता है तो जो बिहेवियर मैनेजमेंट और ये सब जो होगा वो आपके स्पेशल एजुकेटर के पास होगा. तो आपको ये चीजें ध्यान में रखना बहुत जरूरी है कि कौन से थेरेपिस्ट के पास आओ, क्या थेरेपी के लिए जा रहे हो. देन फ्रीक्वेंसी इज अनदर इम्पॉर्टेंट गोल एंड I have a different perspective altogether. If the parent has to take the child for all the three therapies, for example, speech therapy or occupational therapy and remedial, so sab jagah every day to nahi ja sakte hai. To kitna minimum jana chahiye? The parents can openly talk to the therapist and accordingly ki chalo 2 days are enough at remedial, 2 days are enough in OT, and 2 days are enough for speech therapies. Now whoever comes to me, this is again my personal practice or personal opinion, I don't call any children every day. It depends again upon the need and level of the child. So child come minimum once a week to me, and if I think once a week is not actually helping me to achieve the goals, then I call that child twice a week, and in very severe cases it is 3 times a week. So child also gets some time to process the thing. It also reduces the burden on the parents, not only financially but also physically, taking child to different therapy centers. Another thing which we need to understand, that just because aap everyday therapy ke liye ja rahe ho to aapko result jaldi aayega. Aapke bacche ka result utna hi aayega jitne bacche ki level hai aur jitna usko intervention ki zarurat hai. Aisa nahi hota, because bahut sare parents jo mere paas aate hain bahut baar thak jate hain, kyunki 2-3 saal wo every day kisi therapist ke paas gaye hain पर रिजल्ट उतना नहीं आया है, और किसी थेरेपिस्ट ने उनको ये समझाने की कोशिश भी नहीं की है कि अरे उसका सीवियर मेंटल रिटार्डेशन है तो आप मेरे पास एवरीडे लेके आओ या हफ्ते में 2-3 बार लेके आओ, रिजल्ट उतना ही आने वाला है. तो ये आपको बहुत समझने की कोशिश करनी चाहिए कि आपके बच्चे का डायग्नोसिस क्या है, नेचर क्या है डायग्नोसिस का, हम क्या लेवल तक उसको लेके जा सकते हैं, और हम कितनी बार थेरेपी करेंगे तो बच्चा बच्चे में रिजल्ट आ जाएगा. एंड दिस विल हेल्प पेरेंट्स इवेंचुअली टू प्लान फाइनेंशियली आल्सो फॉर ऑल दिस थेरेपीज, बिकॉज यू मे नीड थेरेपी ऑनगोइंग फॉर इन सर्टन केसेस आई विल से. Another important point I would like to add in this, कि therapist के पास everyday नहीं लेके जाना है, इसका मतलब ये नहीं है कि therapy everyday नहीं करनी है. अगर आपका training होता है और आप सीख के आते हो therapist के पास, तो आपको घर में जो उन्होंने home program दिया है वो आपको करना ही है. therapy की everyday जरूरत हो सकती है, पर therapist के पास जाने की जरूरत everyday in most of the cases नहीं होती है. So this is what we call, because and another important thing I would like to add is that sometimes parents do feel ki acha ye to OT mein bhi karwa rahe hain, fir aap bhi karwa rahe ho, acha ye speech therapist bhi ye sikha rahi hai, aap bhi sikha rahe ho, to aapko dhyan mein rakhna hai ki bhale main teaching aid same use kar rahi hu, par mere objective स्पीच थेरेपिस्ट के ऑब्जेक्टिव से थोड़े अलग रहेंगे, और वैसे ही मेरे ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑक्यूपेशनल थेरेपिस्ट से अलग रहेंगे. ये आपको ध्यान में, ऑक्यूपेशनल थेरेपिस्ट मेनली लुक फॉर कि कैसे वो पजल फिक्स कर रहा है, परसेप्शन कैसा है बच्चे का, मैं देखूंगी कि उसका कंसेप्ट कैसा डेवलप हुआ है, कॉग्निटिव एबिलिटी क्या है, रेडीनेस स्किल्स आए हैं कि नहीं. और यह अब जब हम कोलैबोरेशन में काम करते हैं, लाइक आई यूजुअली कोलैबोरेट विथ माय चाइल्ड्स अदर थेरेपिस्ट, क्योंकि वो हम एक दूसरे को मदद करते हैं कि अच्छा बच्चे का ये लेवल है, या मैं बता सकती हूँ ऑटिस्ट को कि मुझे रिजल्ट नहीं आ रहा है, आप देखो कुछ तो आपको चेंज करना पड़ेगा. तो ये थेरेपिस्ट आर इंटर रिलेटेड, दे आर नॉट सेम, एंड इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू हैव अ कोलैबोरेशन अमंग द प्रोफेशनल्स. Thank you. If you have any questions, please go through. Any questions?
Yeah, we have some questions in our chat box. I'll just read out for you. How can we teach a special child online? Like, is there any software where we can teach visually and make understand the language with alphabets?
Right now I'm working with 2-3 kids online where I'm training parents online, and they are like live sessions. I do orient them first, what is the technique and all that, and give them weekly goals or daily goals depending upon the kind of change we want to bring. I'm not aware about any software, if there are any. And I'm sure many special educators are working in that way.
Yeah. There is another question, like, I live in rural part of Tamil Nadu. I'm a special educator, trained and qualified. Here I'm finding it difficult to find a therapist like speech or occupational who are qualified. In that case, how to help parents?
Repeat the question, I didn't get it.
Like, she's saying, I am a special educator, trained and qualified. Here I am finding it difficult to find a therapist like speech or occupational who are qualified. In that case, how to help the parents?
Maybe she can contact the professionals in Tamil Nadu and see if they can train her at certain level, and if the parents can go to that therapist in that particular city, if it is physically possible for them. Or maybe the parents can go and get the home program for that from that respected therapist, and she will help the parent to follow that program.
Is online special education courses available? If so, please suggest.
I'm sorry, I'm not aware of that, if there are any. Because even though there are online courses, we don't know how authentic they are and how recognized they are.
There is another question. For improvement of cognition and memory, etc., please suggest some activities. I guess we are talking about...
we need to have some information before I suggest activities, like the age of the child, the diagnosis of the child, and what is the present level of the child. We need to assess the child before we suggest any activities to you, because it should help the child and not affect the child.
What is the right approach to build expressive written English for middle school children, like IQ is 96.
For having good expressive written expression, it is, if it's the English medium, or like the child is studying in English medium school or regional language, what is it?
She has not specified. Maybe English medium must be, because expressive written English for middle school, she is saying.
We need to work on the child's receptive language and see whether the child has good command on language. If the child learns to think in English, he will learn to express in English in written form. So reading is very important. Reading and understanding that language. Because like I said, we are not English speaking people, all of us. So definitely English is still a foreign language for us, even though, and we are studying in English medium school because we were colony of British. Otherwise we would not have studied in English medium school.
Yeah. Another question from a parent. Can you help us more with the homeschooling, ma'am?
Homeschooling, I will help to some extent, but I have a friend back in Pune who has actually started homeschool, Sunita Lele. I think she should be there in a group. She will be of better help.
Yes, we are fortunate to have her in our webinar. She is there.
Sunita, I have worked in homeschool. I can help you, but more than me, she can help you better. But definitely you can contact me if you need basic information about it, and I can be definitely helping you.
Okay, another question. Can you take online assessment? I think yes, you can.
Yeah, online assessment, depending upon the weather, at least to some extent, we can take online assessment. depending upon the diagnosis of the child again.
Oh, there is one question, I don't know if it's related, but my child has procrastination problem. So is there any treatment for that?
Okay, the counselor will be of help, not I. Again, the psychologist who are specialized in counseling psychology will be of your help.
I think, can you please tell us some pointers using which we can decide if an autistic child is ready for special education? I mean, you mentioned 7 years. Is that dependent on only age or some other components are measured?
Not for autism. That 7 years is for dyslexia, dysgraphia, that is learning disability, and children with ADHD. Once the child gets diagnosed with any disability, you have to start with special educator right away. All the therapies will take place simultaneously. Whether the child has autism or whether the child has mental retardation, usually they do need sensory integration, and after few months or 2-3 months, you can start the remedial education right away. At the age of even 2, at the age of 1, you can start the special education. Like, that's why I mentioned it, because some parents come to me very late. They come at the age of 9, they come to me at the age of 5, because sometimes doctors don't send them, or some therapists really don't know what actually involves as a role in special education. In the role of special educator. So remember that the therapy starts from the time the child is diagnosed. You don't wait. Start the therapy right away. And let the special educator decide whether the child is ready for remedial education or not. Don't let other therapist or doctor decide, because they are expert in their respective field. क्योंकि बहुत बार पेरेंट्स आते और बोलते कि नहीं, हमको उन्होंने अभी भेजा इसलिए मैडम हम अभी आए. इसलिए पूछते कि आप इतने दिन तक क्यों नहीं आए, नहीं उन्होंने बोला नहीं. तो मैं बोली, फिर मुझे बात करनी, नहीं मुझे लगा मैडम कि अभी तो राइटिंग के लिए तैयार नहीं है, क्योंकि बाकी के प्रोफेशनल भी ना राइटिंग को ही, राइटिंग और रेमेडियल एजुकेशन को सिनोनिमसली यूज करते हैं. उनको लगता है राइटिंग इंप्रूव करना है तो स्पेशल एजुकेटर के पास जाना चाहिए. बट वी ऑल नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड कि राइटिंग इज पार्ट ऑफ एकेडमी, और उसके पहले भी काफी सारे रेडीनेस स्किल्स होते हैं, बिहेवियर मैनेजमेंट होता है, वो सब स्पेशल एजुकेटर के पास हो जाएगा.
प्लीज सजेस्ट सम स्पेशल एजुकेशन बुक.
देर आर मेनी, यू कैन जस्ट गूगल इट एंड फिगर इट आउट.
There are many questions. I'm just going through any course. How we can connect? We will provide the contact information of ma'am. Yeah, I think we are done with the questions. Yes, we are done with the questions. Thank you for the wonderful information. I mean, this is the perspective we need to understand, and parents need to understand, because they are just going blindly to the therapist and following various ways. They don't know how to handle all the therapies and everything. So you have included all the insight and excellent information. Thank you so
much. I hope it has satisfied the expectation from the parents who have attended. And thank you very much for inviting.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Sunita Lele ma'am, for attending this and presenting. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Mukta ma'am, for excellent guidance. Thank you.
Thank you.